Okay, welcome to volume 6 of our webinar on advanced JSX-Graph programming. Yeah, today's topic is Jesse code. What is Jesse code? Well, it's a programming language which has been developed by our group, especially by Michael Gerhäuser, who worked here and got his PhD in Bayreuth. Well, it's more or less his child, and well, it's a programming language for doing JSX-Graph. To mention some technical things, Jesse code is open source. It's hosted at GitHub. Here is the GitHub page, and it's, well, the license is LGPL and MIT, the same license as JSX-Graph. So why do we need a programming language on top of JSX-Graph? Well, there are several reasons. One is simplicity. As probably you are all familiar with JavaScript, when you can survive these lectures. So you know that in JavaScript, if you want to plot or access or evaluate the sign function, you have to call math.sign of x. And of course, we all agree that this is not very good if we demand to type math.sign from our students. So, and in JSX-Graph, but in JSX-Graph, this is not necessary, it seems not to be necessary. For example, you can plot x hat 2 to get x to the power of 2, or you can plot sine of x. So there must be some conversion from the usual math syntax to the internal JavaScript syntax math.sign. And this is done automatically all the time with Jesse code already. Well, and the second motivation is security. If you look at this function plotter, in technical terms, it's an HTML input field. And well, the programmer of this little applet expects that the user types in a mathematical formula. But of course, you can type anything like alert or some redirect or you can type any malicious JavaScript code you want, and of course these malicious inputs have to be eliminated. So one possible thing is to filter out the dangerous expressions like eval or a new function or something like that. This can be filtered out or could be filtered out. The main attack is cross-site scripting attacks. So you want to avoid cross-site scripting attacks. So in JSX-Graph, we do it in a different way. We take this string, which is input here, and and parse this string and generate JavaScript code of it. So we don't do not simply filter it out. We apply a parser. And well, it does not provide 100% security, but it is much more secure than a simple filter. then the usage scenario is you may allow students to type in input for function plotters or use Jesse code syntax in a forum discussion, for example. So everybody, so for me, it's not important if I do my own cross-site scripting attack here as a user, but if you plug in, if you allow the input of JavaScript in a forum code, then the others are affected by this cross-site scripting attack. So this is dangerous. And this is where Jesse code is important. And if we have a parser of this language, then it allows us to implement symbolic math methods like derivation, differentiation. So some more details. So the syntax of Jesse code is very close or quite close to JavaScript. So it's very much related. And how is the status of Jesse code? It was started this project in 2011. And it's included in JSXGraph. So if you download JSXGraph, then you have Jesse code included. And for all these function plots, it's used automatically whenever you provide a string. But nobody knows that there is Jesse code behind. But you can do much more, as we will see in the next minutes. But this is not very well known among the JSXGraph users. I guess nearly nobody knows about Jesse code. Thus, this means there's not much feedback yet, and probably there are quite a few bugs still in this language. But we expect if it's gaining more popularity that these bugs will be fixed quickly. So, yes. How do we use Jesse code automatically? Let's say. I have provided an example. Yeah. Look at this example. So, okay. There's no plotting. So I have a slider, simple slider, and I'm creating a function graph, and whenever the function graph is the argument of the parameter here for the function graph is not a JavaScript function, but a string, then this string is parsed by Jesse code and converted into a JavaScript function, and this JavaScript function is evaluated. So it runs like this. And the nice thing is you can access sliders too by name, for example. And then you can and then you can use this slider, and it's also possible to do this. You can just access the slider by its name without any methods. Okay. But I keep this for the moment. And this is also possible for points. Chassis code input is also possible for points. For example, here I'm creating a point at x coordinate pi divided by 2, and y coordinate is the value of the slider. Okay, so the coordinates of the points are functions. And you can do a little bit more. For example, create another point, and this point is the y coordinate of this point is the y coordinate of the point capital P. And remember, capital P is the name of the point. They are connected by the names. And so the y coordinate is of the new point is y point p plus 1. Okay. You get this. Okay, this is automatically possible since several years in JSX Graph. So I didn't install any more library. It's contained in JSX Graph already. Okay. So, and as you saw, mathematical functions can be accessed with math dot. Instead of math dot sign, it's you can use the usual notation. Some care has to be taken if you supply just a single letter for some reason. Sometimes you must change this to 1 times x, so it's recognized as an expression. Yeah. So, and access to slider values, as I said, is by name of the slider, and all other elements also similarly can be accessed by their name and not their chassis code variable name, as we will see later. And what functions are available in this way? Well, quite a few. I've listed in the notes here. You can download the notes from the JSX web page. So if you go to JSX Graph and go to docs, you see all the webinars and the notes of the webinars. And today's notes are already here. Okay. So for example, you have the trigonometric functions, and you have the logarithms and power and exponential functions, and also the hyperbolic functions. So things which are not or binomial, is it here? I don't see it, but it should be here. Functions which are defined in JSX Graph. Or you can also access the distance between two points, the degree of an angle, or the length of a segment, or whenever there's a value. Okay, so this is automatically if you supply a string in for function graph curves and points. So How can you use it in your program if you want to use it somewhere else? And well, for this, there's the function, the method board JC for JC code snippet. So, yeah, let's look at an example. Yeah, let's look at this example. So this is the usual setting. We have a div, JSXcraft board. And for the moment, we have a text string in the variable txt, which contains a Jesse code string. So the first possibility is to create a function out of it with this method board JC snippet, where you supply the string true for, because you want to have a function, and if necessary, you can't, or usually it's necessary, you will have to supply the parameters of this functions. So this will be X. yeah, so if this function has two parameters, you have to supply X comma Y or something like that. Yeah, oh, there's a chat. How to plot something like this? Yeah. Oh, this is pain in my heart. This is an implicit plot, and I hope we can publish a usable version of implicit plots during the summer. I hope it. Yeah. Okay. But you can input the function like x. You could input the function like x squared plus y squared minus 4. This is already possible. Okay. So, yeah. Let's do this. Okay, it runs, and we can plot this function f now. So now we supply this JavaScript variable f to as parameter for this function graph, and it runs. Okay, and I hope this works in JSFiddle. We can output f to string. If you want to see, I don't see my console. Yeah, maybe it's not that important. Then you will see the Jesse code. And if you want to see the resulting JavaScript code, you have to log f to js. Okay. So what happens if you don't use a true here? This is this is used for expressions like this one. So you want to calculate something. So 2^3 times log 2 of 4. Then, with my console, I don't see it at the moment, but you can do this and it will be 64. So it will be parsed and evaluated. This is the main goal if you supply here a force. So you can use you use Jesse code as a calculator. Yeah. Okay, this is the use of Jesse code in JavaScript or in JSX graph. You pass expressions with a board JC snippet. Okay, then there's more. Let's look at this example. So there's nothing beside a script tag. A script tag with type text Jesse code, here Jesse code, and an attribute access equals true. Okay, then what do you see? Indeed, you see a JSX graph board with some standard access from -5 to 5 and -5 to 5 in both directions. So we can, the first step is we want to change this view. And this can be done like this. I will say, I will do the demonstration and we'll show you, we'll say more about it in a few seconds. Then we can do things like this. Yeah. We can do a plot. This looks familiar, but also strange. So we have here a variable g and a function called function graph. And then inside as parameter, there seems to be something like a function. And this function is also using exp, so it reminds me of Jesse code. So indeed, this is Jesse code. And we can do things like that. We can create a slider in exactly the same way. So we call slider. So this is the principle of Jesse code. You can do a lot of things, but you can, instead of this board create in JSX graph, you can just supply the same name which you create in JSX graph. So if you have here this string slider, then there will be the Jesse code method or function slider or point. There will be a point and function graph, and as parameters of this function, you have to supply the values which you would supply in the square brackets. You supply it in parentheses. Oops. Here. So here we just supply as function, and this is a function in Jesse code syntax, or we supply here the defining coordinates of the slider. And then we have attributes for JSX graph in a JavaScript object notation. And this is done exactly the same way. Except that we have to use these double less or greater symbols for the brackets. Okay, and then we have one more type of function, namely something like this. This is a map. And you see it reacts to the slider. So instead of this, well, bulky function notation, we have an arrow notation similar to JavaScript and to modern JavaScript, except that you have to supply this map keyword. And there's a single line here and not a double line, as in JavaScript. Okay, and this maps, this generated this function s times sine x. And now you can access both s, this s or that s. It doesn't matter. Okay. And well, and you can suppose that you also can create a glider. So we can create a glider on this on this function f, function graph s, with some coordinates. So there's a constant pi available. So here's the glider. It has the name p and the id p id. And well, and we can also move this glider by move to, with a move to command. This is similar to JSX graph. We can also alternatively, we can access it with a move command and access the slider by its name or by its ID. And the ID can be accessed a little bit like jQuery. So you use this dollar notation and an ID. Works all the same. Okay. Yeah, here's another example for the capabilities of Jesse code. Same situation. And we have loops, for example. So loops. So this is a for loop. And it, the loop is exactly like loops in JavaScript. Besides, we just have this increasing of the counter variable. We will create points with a position, well, random is a value between 0 and 1. It's a math random. And in both directions. And we convert it to be a value between -5 and 5. And then it looks like this. Okay. These points can be dragged. So these are constant values which are supplied. So it's not dynamic. If you want to have a dynamic version of a loop, creating points, then we have to do it like that, like this. Namely, we supply maps. Okay, And this is a little annoyance of Jesse Code. While we don't have this map dot doesn't need a parameter, but we have to supply one, otherwise it will throw an error. But if it's not used, then it doesn't harm. So this is, and if you drag it, all the board is updated, and each point gets an, each of the blue point gets a new coordinate pair randomly. Okay. Yeah, and what you can do with, as I said, what you can do with Jesse Code is you can do some symbolic math. For example, now we are back in this in the JSX graph JavaScript setting. Yeah, maybe I want to mention it. So if you, oops, if you, you may allow your students or students to supply this inside of this script tag into a forum, forum post, and this is relatively secure. Yeah, now we are back in this JavaScript setting. So we have a construction, and well, what is constructed? The first thing is a slider. The first element is a slider, as we know it. Then we create a function graph with Jesse Code syntax, r a to the power of x. And then we differentiate this function, a to the power of x. So we compute the differential quotient a dax by dx. Okay, and this is this red curve. And to see the effect, if you look at this output here, let's look at this part. So I can input here a map, well, any Jesse Code code, and what happened here, so this is this text area, what you see, and below there's another text area, and when clicking on simplify code, here on simplify code, the function parse is called, and parse, what does it do? It calls the method manipulate of Jesse Code, which simplifies the syntax a little bit or executes it. So let's look at the result. So the input is x to the power of 2, and the derivative of f is called, is set to h, then h is 2 times x. So we can do it a little bit more complicated, slightly more complicated, and compute the derivative of sine of x squared. Yeah, so this is already possible. I missed it, but want to address the questions here. It seems that Jesse Code is translated to JavaScript, so there should not be a big performance penalty in using it. Right, completely right. So you can turn on the control settings. Okay, sorry, I missed that. And as parameter as a parameter for function graph in map, does white spaces matter? No, they don't matter. Same as in JavaScript. Okay. So if you want to do symbolic derivatives in a language, then you need algebraic simplification. So there is some algebraic simplification already included into JessieCode, but I would be happy if somebody would help out and do it in a fundamental good way. This is just a hack, so there we would need help to get it better. Can be rendered in, yeah. Can the symbolic math output be rendered in math checks? So you see, this is the output. So we need, what we would need is another filter, which replaces, for example, the stars by a C dot and cos by backslash cos. But this would be not that much, that difficult, because we have an abstract syntax tree. I'll write it here. The parser generates an abstract syntax tree, and this can be, from this you can derive anything if there's enough motivation. And well, this would be, instead of this manipulate, it would be good to have something like get LaTeX output or something like that. This would be a good suggestion. And now finally something much more involved, a little bit more involved, namely I want to look at the interplay between JessieCode and JSX graph. Let's first look at this construction. So what happens? There seems to be a counter, and I can increase it by clicking on this button. And there's a circle. Now the circle suddenly disappears. I still increase the counter, and then it comes back. Okay. What does it do? Though this example keeps a counter inside of JessieCode. And you can do this, generate a JessieCode namespace, so to say, by calling board JC parse counter equals now. Zero. So then this counter will exist inside, the counter variable will exist in JessieCode. There's a point and a circle. Okay, and this circle should react somehow to this counter variable in JessieCode. This is, therefore, we call board JC snippet and check if the counter is between 5 and is 6, between 6 and 9, then the circle visibility is set to false, otherwise it's set to true. Okay. Then, so this circle can access via port chassis snippet the counter variable in chassis code. And the same is with the button. The button just calls a function where this chassis code is evaluated, namely counter is set to counter plus one. And finally, the text creates a function which returns the counter value. Okay, this is a little bit more complex in case you need this interplay between chassis code and if you have to access chassis code variables in JSX graph. Yeah, in my notes in the script, I included a chassis code language reference. So the data types, functions, maps. Data types are just a Boolean string number objects, and objects are accessed with this notation, as I mentioned it. Comments, there's only the double slash comment, and you have the usual operators beside the head symbol is exponentiation. And we have comparisons, of course, and and if, while, do, for. You have some predefined constants. I will answer to your question in a second. Then you have update. You can update. I can call an board update. You can add handlers, event handlers, and so on. And here are a few examples how elements are accessed. Yeah. And yeah, okay. Yeah, how does the reactivity work behind the scenes? It's a question in the chat. Actually this question is not directly dependent on chassis code, because you can supply the attribute visible with a function which returns true or false. And whenever something happens inside the board, every element is updated and the visibility, the attribute visible is checked. So this function is evaluated. If it's true, then the circle is displayed. Otherwise, it's not displayed. So this is, so to say, the usual JSX graph update mechanism. And the new thing is that you can supply also access to a chassis code object. So if you want to know more about this update, about this reactivity, you have to look at my first webinar. There it's explained. So each object, is its own observer. Yeah, I hope you like chassis code now and consider it to be used. As I said, there are a lot of little things like this necessary parameter of a map, which are a little bit annoying, still annoying, but if we get more feedback, we can change it. Okay, then at the end, I want to tell you something about upcoming events. So there will be three upcoming events. Namely, there's an online teacher training course on programming JSX graph starting at the end of May. It runs 2 weeks, and and there will be three online meetings and homework in between. It's organized by University of Maribor, Slovenia. And it's, you don't have to be a teacher to take part. So I want to recommend it. Oh, I would be happy if you recommend it to your colleagues, which are new to JSX-Graph, to get an insight into JSX-Graph and do the first steps. So the requirements, none. This course is intended for non-programmers. Yeah, and it's free, and you can register at this address. Then the next webinar will be on June 9th, same place. Oh, I will publish the Zoom address. And I'm very happy that we can announce the second International JSX-Graph Conference. It will take place online again, and will be from October 5th to October 7th. And yeah, we would be happy if you register and announce talks about your work with JSX-Graph and other exciting things. Thank you very much. And well, hope to see you in June. And we are at the end of today, and see you in June, and have fun with JSX-Graph. Goodbye.